my goal.
Hello everyone, I see lots of fine folks in the chat. I heard ducks were eating geese. I'm sure Sinoise isn't happy that geese are being consumed in the chat right about now.
I thought you would be hunting swans.
But yeah, welcome everyone. I see Chris here. I saw Paul drop a Prime gift sub earlier, which caught Goodwill's eye.
Cheapskate!
Insert the goose. We got Sarah Peach dropping in for a little bit before D&D. We love you. Sorry you couldn't stick around, but there'll be an archive. I see a Joe Border there as well. This is excellent. Right. What's that? Captain Goodwill has arrived. This is actually... we'll get into it. But welcome everybody to episode 5 of the Gaming Up North Ramblecast, the Guncast, as we definitely call it every week. This week we're talking Mass Effect, just general series, not one game in particular. But yes, I am joined as always by my lugubrious host, Mr. Adam Ashbridge. How are you doing tonight?
Why, hello there. You're glad yourself?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm having fun. I feel like this is an important night tonight. We have gathered a new crewmate, it would seem. He's stowed away on the bad ship Ramblecast. We have the first human Spectre, Commander Goodwill.
I'm Commander Goodwill, and this is my favorite Ramblecast on the Citadel.
He said the line, folks. He gets the prize. That means you get special Gaming Up North discount for our many products that we sell.
That 2.5% discount that we offer.
Adam, list off the products. What did you say? Goose bake was.
No.
Hush, 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 yeah. Hush.
Goose bake.
You get a plug cover.
Oh my god, those are like solid gold around here.
A harmonica and Mario and half a bottle of Carex hand sanitizer. That's what you get.
Yep.
A vast array of plectrums.
Yep. 50 plain hot dogs delivered under my discretion.
I'm going to pretend you're the New York Knicks.
Chris wants gun ramble thongs. That has a certain ring to it.
No.
Oh, Goodwill says, I'm here, but I'm actually playing Mass Effect. Oh, sorry, Joe Border says, I'm here, but I'm actually playing Mass Effect, endlessly scanning planets.
I was about to say, I'm here, and I'm playing Mass Effect.
Well, there is a clone.
Probing Uranus.
There is a clone. There is a clone of Shepard at some point. So stranger things have happened in space.
True.
Oh, actually, hang on a sec. I think we've got another guest. Is that Lee? Do I see? Oh, hi, Lee.
Oh my God.
How are you doing?
Oh God. Oh my Jesus. Look at the state of him.
Did you enjoy your breakfast on Saturday, mate?
Yes, how was that breakfast?
Ah, he's not saying anything.
Hello.
Oh, hang on, I know what it is.
What?
Oh, he's got himself a brown egg.
Oh my God!
Oh, he's no good for like 40 minutes once he gets his hands on one of these.
Oh, he's
got
that
egg bean, Lee.
He's got to chow down on that brown egg.
Oh, we'll just have to leave him. He's no good to us now.
Wish I had a brown egg, not the ones that gave me food poisoning.
Heyo!
But something was brown after that. Hey, where have you gone, Lee? Lee?
Oh, yeah, he disappeared into a small... It looks like a thing. Small line, which I'll now make disappear. I'm now a magician, apparently. Oh, but welcome everyone. We're here to talk about Mass Effect, trials, tribulations of old Mr. Jake Shepard, he was called, I believe, in the games.
No, Michael.
Really? Yeah. Oh, but yeah, like, so these are really, really awesome BioWare RPGs that we all love a lot. Mm-hmm. And I thought I would get... Well, to be honest, Goodwill muscled his way into this podcast because it's almost the closest we've gotten to good Star Trek in video games, would you say?
Yes.
Yeah, and it's also one of my top three sci-fi franchises of all time.
Yeah. They really like nailed the sort of the serious vibe of Star Trek. I know like Star Trek has like comedy moments and so does this, but they nailed that whole, like, extraterrestrial political kind of... They call it space
world
opera, I guess.
Building.
Yeah. Mm. But also, I think they got the aesthetics, like, spot on for what I wanted. I mean, it's a little more military than Star Trek, but they've definitely got, like, you know, the shiny ships and everything. Very clean, you know, like, decks and everything. Not like... very clean design as well, but not, like, dirty... sci-fi like Star Wars and stuff like that where everything's a bit grimy.
Get a mop, Star Wars.
Yeah.
You don't want to see what Chewbacca's been doing in that back room with the old Falcon.
He had the eggs from Saturday, that's what he had.
Get off me brown egg.
Yeah, get off me brown egg.
You can't invoke Lee, you can't interrupt him. You know what, if nobody, I'm not going to explain the story, but if I'm going to make you ask Lee about it every time he comes on his own stream.
What made it worse, he swallowed them whole. Which sent Graham into some sort of paralysis. It was a whole thing. Anyway.
It was.
Egg paralysis.
No, Ducky, you can't ask what happened in this chat. You have to ask him when he's on his own stream. Yeah. But yes, so I want to ask you guys, when was the first time you ran into Mass Effect as a series? Like, did you hear about it before it was coming out, or was it like, what the hell is this looks great? Like, have you got a story?
You go first, Goodwill.
Oh, God, how long have you got?
Spin us a yarn.
Spin us a yarn. Actually, I came to these games quite late. It was 2012.
Mm.
And I was working at a rather shitty job in Shildon for a shitty manager who did a shitty job at organising a shitty business.
The Shildon shit shoveler.
It was a Shildon shit show. Yeah. And I was, yeah, I'd just got my first decent pay packet because they hadn't paid me correctly in 3 months. And, and I was looking for some games to buy on PS3. And I'd always knew about Mass Effect. And obviously Mass Effect 2 came out on the PS3, I believe, in 2011.
Yeah, because it was like, sounds about right.
Or was it 2010? I believe it was 2010 or 2011. But the advantage it had over the 2009 360 version was this was fully made in the Mass Effect 3 engine.
Mm-hmm.
So they were like, right, we know you guys have never had Mass Effect 1, so we'll have a comic book version, and then you can play Mass Effect 2 in Mass Effect 3's engine. So it's all brand new, and it's like, yeah, it's an exclusive reason to buy it on the PS3. And like I said, I'd heard about Mass Effect, but I didn't know anything about it. I hadn't done any research. And the more I read about it, I was like, this actually looks quite good. And I bought it. And I swear, I played it for an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And I left it for a month.
Really?
Because I was really, really busy at the time. But the hour I played, I loved it. But then I just, you know, a job just takes over your life.
Yeah.
And then I was made redundant. So I was like, yay, I've got actual time to play now. And I got back into it and I started afresh because I was like, oh, I only played an hour a month ago. I'm just going to start from afresh and here we go. And holy shit, very few games have made me not leave a room and not turn off the console for 12 to 14 hours like Mass Effect.
Getting real stinky session going on.
Yeah. And back then I was like, so it was feisty. The Pringle sour cream and chive and the Relentlesses, tropical fruit Relentlesses, were just oozing out of my body.
Ladies, he's single.
And I was hooked.
Such a good house.
Don't worry, ladies, there's plenty of good old to share. But I was absolutely hooked on it. And I mean, I'd never played Mass Effect 1, but 2 and the digital comic did such a good job in sort of being like, oh, you never played the first one? That's cool. We'll just drop you into the game and then subtly educate you on what happened. Yes, there's a digital comic if you want to pay it, but you can find out everything on your way.
Yeah.
And holy shit, I blitzed that game for a solid week, and I'd finished it within the week, and I went back and I played it again. Like, straight away, I went back and played it again. Mm-hmm. Because I was like, yeah, some of my choices were a bit dodgy and I didn't really know what I was doing.
Yeah.
So I'm going to perfect it this round. And I was a paragon all the way through. Because I got the shit ending at first because I didn't know what the fuck I was doing.
Oh.
So I perfected it. And then I think it was a couple of weeks later, Mass Effect 3 came out. Those were some of the most feistiest weeks of my life. And I think I needed to fumigate the room after it, but holy shit, like, it was a game changer in terms of storytelling, in terms of gameplay, in terms of music, and it was just, it blew me away. And very few, have you ever played a game, guys, where you've played it that much that it just bleeds into your dreams on a night? And you're actually living
and you're like,
that was Mass Effect.
The thing that's happened the most with me is, like, when I was a kid, I'd play like Zelda on like the Game Boy, and I'd like solve puzzles in my sleep. Like I'd get stuck and I'd go to sleep and then I'd wake up and be like, I know the solution. Like it was just like going,
I don't need sleep, I need answers.
Yeah, my brain must have just been ticking over with like Zelda puzzles.
I mean, like I said, it was February till April that these games consumed my lives. And I remember playing the first, my first round of Mass Effect 3, and just, you know, in the game where it's just constantly a no win and everything's failing and everything's going wrong,
yeah,
and it just bled into my dreams, and I'm just like, there must be a way, there must be a way. And I just, everything was so vivid in my dreams at this point, and it just, I've never had a game since then that has consumed me in that way, and it's been very hard to topple those. And this was like 11, 12 years ago.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I still remember those couple of months so vividly. And every time I play them, because people say like, oh, why don't you play Mass Effect on Twitch? I can't, because it's one of those games that's just too personal for me.
Yeah.
That I can't share that experience because it's
so. I can't let you in
because it was at a time where I was unemployed, I was feisty as fuck, and I just it was an intimate experience to have that. And obviously with it being an RPG, everything was your decision, and you know you could pretend it was you in this fantastic universe. And I would just sit there and read like all the texts, the data logs and everything like that. And I would just get so enveloped in the world.
You would read some of them, but then some of them, that man with the excellent voice would read out for you codex entries, wouldn't he?
God, what a voice that fella had. Yeah, like, Lurpak.
Yeah, like, how about you, Adam? Because, like, I was, like, in on the first one, but a bit late. But, like, when did you hit the series?
I think once again it was something you introduced me to.
Oh, the old trade 'em up, eh?
Yeah. Mass Effect 2. You had Mass Effect 2.
So that's the first one you played as well.
Yeah. And I think I ended up buying it not long after you showed me it.
Yeah.
And I was like obsessed, like Goodwill. I would just like. I think once again I wasn't working at that time.
Yeah.
So I just sat and played Mass Effect for hours on end and just kept going and going, like sleeping during the day and playing during the night sort of thing. Once again, with probably Pringles and energy drinks, I think. That was the way forward.
Did you guys both pick the man chef?
Yeah, and I modelled it after me, and I remember my first attempt, the nose was so fucking hooked. Because I don't know if anyone can see it, I've got like a really bent nose, because my nose got broke twice when I was younger. Within a week, it got broke twice.
Did the boys beat you?
No, I fell off my skateboard and landed straight on my face. And then a week later, my ex-girlfriend kicked me in the face as we were play fighting.
Like,
that's not play fighting, that's domestic violence. Wow. So
it was Goodwill Hawk.
I wish it was a Tory, because then I would have been rich. But it was, the character design, I did it as myself, being a narcissist.
Yeah, I mean, I usually just make, like, a buff version of me with, like, black hair, like, you know, black long hair, and like, that. What would I look like if I was a bit more like The Undertaker?
Jake Burton swore.
Yeah, but in Mass Effect, I went with FemShep immediately. There wasn't really a choice, and nothing really impacted that choice. I was kind of just like, this guy looks a bit normal and like every other like video game protagonist at the time, because this was the time period of bald space marine, like shaved head space marine. I've since done a bit of replaying, and he's great. Like there's nothing wrong with him, but like I went with Jennifer Hale. The way I got into this game was I was literally just sat bored being like, I need a new game to play. So I must have like clicked around IGN for a little while, like looking up like top review stuff for like 360. Because I got into the 360 a little bit later. Like we jumped on because me and Adam had been watching videos of Call of Duty 4 when that was about to come out. It was probably like a good few months before it came out when the first beta hit.
Yeah.
And Call of Duty was decent.
Yeah, we were just enthralled by it and being like, what, we can just sit down together and we're going to be able to like play these like death matches on this like awesome photorealistic looking landscape at the time. So I got a Xbox 360 when the Elite hit and Halo 3 was already out or just about to come out. So I'd kind of missed all the hype about anything 360. So I was clicking around IGN and I was like, this is one of their top reviewed games. And I was like, well, I do like RPGs and I like space. And I was like, but I've just never heard of Mass Effect because it was like a new series. Like, we don't get many of those anymore, but this was just a new Uncharted like thing, being like, Mass Effect, that isn't a remake of like, you know, old games from the 90s. And I saw some, I watched their video review, which I think at the time would have been like 9 minutes because nobody did long form video back then apart from Giant Bomb. And yeah, like I was like, oh, this is cool, he's running around on the moon, he's got a little space buggy, I'll jump in. And I definitely had one of those like massive like sweaty sessions where I'm just like getting, I probably got up to like that planet with like the plant zombies or something. I think I went there first. But yeah, I was just like, I've been waiting for a game like this almost my whole sort of like since the PlayStation 2 days, because it was like, it wasn't too hard because it was like an RPG. It had some action, but the shooting was kind of weird, but it just had like enough of everything. And then the writing is what like 100% won me over. And I don't think before that I'd sat and like read a lot of like dialogue in RPGs, but in this one I was like, I'm gonna talk to everyone, I'm gonna use every direction on the the conversation wheel. It's interesting that you guys both got the good gameplay Mass Effect experience first, though, because one is it's got its charms, but it's the shooting is very strange.
Sorry, Adam.
I'm saying it's very clunky, the first one.
In parts, for sure.
They'd ported it over. They re-released Mass Effect 2 and 3 and then included 1 as a downloadable.
Was it like Legacy or something? Legacy Edition. Yeah.
And it was literally a direct port from the 360.
Yeah. Did have the film grain on it still.
Yes.
Aggressive film grain.
Very grey.
I remember playing it and I'm like, wow, Mass Effect 2 is really good. And then the Legendary Edition came out in 2021. And they were like, oh, we're making all these significant things. And everyone was like, if you're going to do it, why don't you do what you did with Mass Effect 2 and just make it in the 3 engine?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You've got the technology, and then you've got clear, concise gameplay throughout, so it'll be 1, 2, and 3 with 3's engine, so nothing changes. It's just literally different stories and everything like that.
And I'm sure they could probably mostly leave the cutscene parts. It's literally just the combat running
just
around
sections. Combat, yeah. And I remember playing, and yes, they made some improvements, but yeah, it was still very but I think that added to Mass Effect 1's charm, where every outpost was just a maze of corridors in a cave.
Yeah, to be honest, in Mass Effect 1, I pretty much mainlined the story, because like you say, it was like land on an identical planet and drive around, and then a Thresher Maw would come out and destroy your makeup.
Run a few people over as you do,
and they would sort of roll around, and then you would like reverse up and then point your weird gun and be like, nah. But like, so I mainlined the story, but it was there like any moments that like massively like stood out to you in like the one story that you think people, that is worth going back to look at? Because like my number one, I guess it's quite late on, other than meeting the cast, which is like the crewmates, which is great. But like story moments, I think the first time is when you're about to like assault the last base before the Ashley Caden choice. To me, it was an easy one. And you get that little Salarian guy who's doing his, you basically talk him into doing like a movie level speech, don't you, for all his men?
Yeah.
And he's like, they said you were all like terrible, and like we've only got 20 men, but we are gonna hold the line. And he keeps like repeating that over and over again. I just remember being think like, oh, go on, little man, like we're gonna go fuck shit up. and then when you get to talk to a Reaper, is like, that was like so crazy and like unsettling and scary. And all it is a conversation with no, like, gameplay wise, there is nothing you can do to like persuade or like renegade that alien to like not do what he's gonna do and show up in the sequel, I guess, is what they decided to do.
Yeah.
But I just remember being so unsettled because of like the voice processing they had as well.
Yeah.
It just sounded alien. But yeah, like for you guys, is there anything that stands out in one that like blew you away or that you think people should check out if they get the chance?
For me, it was just Saren's character.
Oh, you liked Saren, did you?
I fucking loved him, yeah. Even though he was like the bastard of the game. Just any time he popped up, I was like, oh, he got his like proper, like he was doing his job as a villain.
Yeah.
Just get, oh, you slimy bastard. Like, he's got all the skill in the world, but he fucking runs away every time. Look, I'm only a man, a small man on the game.
Oh, and, God, I just remembered as well, like, the Reaper you talk to is his ship. They're always talking about, like, Saren's, like, flagship thing. And it's, like, it's actually, like, one of the most fucked up, like, techno nightmare creatures in the entire universe. And it's just been there the whole time.
Yeah. Just lurking about, and he's just like, oh, I'm this specter, and
good
well,
word.
Disgraced specter, and but yeah, it's just like a cat and mouse chase through the whole game.
It does. You're right, though. It does get you riled up because there's a few conversations where you're like, "Damn it, I saw him. He's up to no good," and the council's just like, well, you humans are so emotional.
Are you sure about that?
it's like, could you be any more racist? Where it's just like, this dude is dodgy. Oh, you humans and your knowledge. Well, I tell you. Yeah.
That's one weird thing about Commander Shepard as a character, because you go and you get like everything explained to you as if you're like a new person. But like, I know you get to choose a few backstories, but he grew up in this this world with mass relays and stuff like that, as far as I'm aware. Like, he probably shouldn't need explanations on, like, why are you in a suit all the time, Quarian, and stuff like that. But
my organs will be on the outside.
Somebody's got to be the like the audience surrogate, I guess.
Yeah, true.
But it just seemed a bit weird. He was such of a blank slate, even though you were supposed to have this like military career beforehand.
Well, because all he did was shoot people before then, wasn't it? Like, he never spoke to people by the sounds of it.
I think so. And you could pick like
until the incident.
Oh yes, which is very video gamey and happens in almost everything. I just started Starfield like last week, and it's the same intro where you touch the space obelisk and go.
My goo.
But that does set him on a path to be the most important person in the entire galaxy, because the precursor race, which also shows up a lot in famous RPGs.
Yep.
Helps him out. But like, what did you guys think of like the one cast? Because like, I absolutely love Rex. I love hanging around with Rex. I love listening to his stories. Like, I always like the gruff older guy whose respect you have to earn.
I felt he was quite diminished in Mass Effect 2.
Yeah, he never really comes back fully, but maybe they didn't want to because they were like, we've done him, but I don't know.
Garrus.
Garrus. Your most well-adjusted Garrus that you get in the series before he gets changed by your adventures, basically.
The only way he can handle trauma is calibrating a gun.
Yes.
That's all he can do. That's his coping mechanism, so leave him be.
Garrus was my one true love in from, I think it was 3, I picked him up. He was the one with me to the very end.
Yeah, has to be.
I don't think you're allowed to date him as a man, though, are you? Like, because that's the thing.
No, you can.
Can you? I don't think so. I don't know. I've never tried.
I could have swore they'd patched it in 3.
Possibly.
So the option was there. I might have to double check.
Because BioWare makes these games, and they're well versed in this type of game. Well, actually, they had Knights of the Old Republic before this, which is basically Mass Effect. If anyone's like wants to see this, but a little bit rougher around the edges and in a universe, you know, like Knights of the Old Republic is basically that. But yeah, they've always had this bit of a dilemma where they're like, okay, which characters can the male characters sleep with? Which characters can the female characters sleep with? Because they've always let you make your own. And it's always this funny thing where, in hindsight, it seems really backwards and kind of like a bit of a strange thing, and be like, oh, the women get less choices sometimes. Until 3, and I think that, like Goodwill says, they opened it up a bit.
I think pretty much in 3 and Andromeda, they were just like, you can fuck anything. Power conduit, have at it.
I think I was...
Even a Hanar.
I wasn't faithful, if I think, on my first playthrough. I think I was like Liara in 1. Then in 2, because Liara had left, I was like, I guess Yeoman Chambers is pretty cool. I'll see. Then I think she leaves. So then in 3, I was like, you know what, Garrus, we've always been there for each other. Maybe this was like a long time will they, won't they. And every time Garrus was about to ask me out, I asked somebody else out, and he just never got the chance. And that was my headcanon. And then by the end, we're like sitting on top of a roof shooting cans on the overpass. Like,
like for me, it was Liara in the first one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But then Miranda, 2.
Mm-hmm. I stole your heart with her gigantic ass.
But the thing is, because I liked John Strahovski in real life.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh man, it's just the Chuck situation all over again.
Seeing her in Mass Effect 2, I was like, that's the bird from Chuck. I love this. And then it was like, and I was like, that was my choice as well, Adam. It was like, it was Liara Tassoni. And then again, like most of the Mass Effect 1 characters, they were relegated in Mass Effect 2.
I mean, I like how nobody's dated the racist Ashley. Who's just like,
no.
It's just like she's nice to you at first, and then she gives that kind of like that thing that like really like creepy people do, where she like tests out a bit of space racism on you and sees if you go along with it.
Yeah,
she was just toxic.
Racism, it's like,
and like as much as Caden bores the hell out of me, like when it comes to a life, like when it comes to them, both their lives on the line, like Caden's got more potential. He can do more good in this world.
Why did I have to choose? Why can't it be both?
Would you have just left them both?
Yeah, because like I said, you got Space Karen, and then you've got Dull Character 6498, and it's just it made, like, even in Mass Effect 3, she's boring as fuck on a stretcher. And it's just that as soon as I saw her, do you remember that trailer they did for Mass Effect 3? And you see her on a battlefield, and I'm just like, oh my god, she's just going to ask for the manager. That's all she's going to do.
In a new, like, blue power suit that they gave her.
Yeah. And she's just like, I want to see your supervisor.
God, no.
Fuck off. Sorry.
you can say.
You can say whatever you want on the Ramblecast, mate.
You can say the naughty F words.
Like, she's on a stretcher. She's just like, leave me alone. Good.
Oh, yeah, because they get like injured in the earth attack, don't they? And you have to sort of like, go by the hospital bed. No.
Yeah, the what's when you're on Mars? Is it Mars?
Mars, yeah.
Okay.
That doctor who stole all the data.
Mm.
And James comes in and like rams their ship, like the little
yeah.
And then she gets like squashed underneath the wreckage. And I was just getting, oh man, she didn't die.
So
James is amazing. Sorry.
No, it's all right. I was kind of just gonna go through some of the one cast a bit, because we had Liara, who's our intrepid young scientist, who's the only other person who believes you that there's secret
young
messages.
Young.
Well, I don't know. How old is she, Goodwill?
She's only about 100-ish, you know.
Oh, yeah, but isn't she a child for Asari culture? Like,
Yeah, because they can live to be 1,000 years old.
So yeah, she's so like she's like 10 years old.
Yeah. Oh no! Oh, bad touch.
Bad touch.
Whoa! Hang on! Hang on! Hello, Operation Yew Tree. Yes,
Shepherd.
Just goes into a quarters. Your letter was only the. Psh.
Yeah. This is my favorite crush on the Citadel.
Ye old cradle robber. And then, oh, who else did we have? Why am I blanking? Tali.
Yes.
Tali.
Tali's our. Tali's our. What was her name? Tali's our.
I don't know.
Well, she became Vas Normandy.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Tali's our. Yeah, she was. Yeah, at the end.
That was pretty cute. I don't have the best relationship with Tali because I might have sided with Legion in Mass Effect 3, and I think she died.
she unalived herself.
It wasn't really what I had in mind for the encounter. It was one of those moments in games where you're like, did I really do this? Like,
yeah,
you didn't get the good ending.
No. And then was that it for the crew in the first one? It was a little.
They're not Rex, Caden, Ashley, Liara, Tali Zora.
I think that was it, wasn't it?
I'm going to double check.
There isn't really any, because they weren't doing DLC characters then. Not yet.
Well, not really. The DLC for Mass Effect 1, wasn't it?
It was like some stupid, like, gladiator arena type of thing, I think, where you could go and, like, bet on stuff.
So it was Caden Alenko, Talizora Naria, Leavra Tassoni, Garrus, Ashley, and Erdnot Rex.
Yeah, okay. I'm glad we didn't forget anybody. We might forget some.
Squad on the first one.
Yeah, we might forget some people in the second game.
I've got the list.
Yeah, see him.
Well, I'm glad. But yeah, coming into this as a woman, like, immediately Miranda set my hackles up, and I was like, no way, sister. Like, I'm the renegade on this ship. Because I played renegade as well, like, through the entire game.
What a bastard were in these games.
Well, what I sort of did, I kind of made the decisions I felt like, you know, at the time. Like, I saved the sort of the weird parasite arachnid queen. I saved her. I was like, no, I'm not gonna melt you. I was kind of thinking of the long game. I was like, one day I'm gonna want a giant thing on my side.
A telekinetic spider.
It didn't really work out, but oh. I tried. What are the other sort of big deciding moments? Because there's that. Oh, there's the plant monster. You can like save her, can't you? Like the green Asari that comes out because she's all like changed by the plant stuff. You can try and save some of those people. Try and shoot gas at them so you don't just murder all the zombies.
Yeah.
Fuck the husks though. They're just dead.
Never mind.
Could never be saved. But yeah, how cool was the start of Mass Effect 2 though? Like I know you guys maybe didn't have all the context of the Normandy exploding, but like seeing your home get viciously destroyed, chopped in half, and then you having to like, we forgot Joker.
Yes.
having to save Joker like right before everything goes to shit because he's like, I'm gonna pilot this to the very end, and you're like, Joker, get away, get in the
I must make
pod.
More episodes of Robot Chicken. For God's sakes, get off the ship.
Shut up. You can tell him to shut up a lot if you play a Renegade. But yeah, like that scene though where you just like die in space because your suit's like lost pressure, and it's just like you can see them writhing around, and then they just fly off into orbit of whatever that planet is, and you just sat there being like, and the title card comes up for Mass Effect 2 and you're just like,
the end.
What?
it was an era where dramatic openings, cold openings, were all the rage. We had it with, even in movies and stuff, because I think Star Trek 09 came out the same year, and that was just like, Oh, yeah, Chris Hemsworth just rams himself into a ship and Kirk gets born and everyone dies. Bye. And then it was like Uncharted, where it's just like, Uncharted 2, you're hanging off a cliff on a train.
Yeah.
And then you look at this and it's just like, oh, you know, this character that you loved and you played 100 hours of, yeah, he's dead now, falling into a planet. Mass Effect 2! And you're just like... But then people are like, is Shepard dead? Do I have to create a new character to find him? What? Yeah. And it's just... to go in balls first.
Yeah.
For that. And I think not playing the first one, it didn't have an effect. But then playing the first one and then going into that, I'm like, yeah, I can sort of understand why people were taken aback and shocked about it.
Yeah, and even it was just the fact that you'd loaded up the second game and you were immediately thrust into, like, tragedy on what is your home, and it's like the same layout basically, and you're just like, no, you can't do this.
But then we had the $6 million man rebuild.
Oh yeah, which I did like, in because I didn't actually want to play as a different character or anything.
No.
So I was happy that the just friggin' magic scienced it and were like, we've just. Those are like, you know, this does this tech exist? Like, we created the tech just
we
for you.
We can rebuild him.
We spit, but they explain it away so heavily, where they're like, they talk about how expensive and crazy the procedures are, and that, like, just so you can't go, like, well, can't all the characters just come back? You know, like, this was like a one-off deal that cost
trillions.
All of our finances just on getting you back.
Yeah. This is like an entire planet's worth of money to bring back this dude. I also love, obviously, with the scars, if you played Renegade, the scars got worse. Mm-hmm. And if you played Paragon, the scars healed up. And I love that Metal Gear 5 just straight up stole that premise.
Yeah, with the spike of, like, shrapnel.
The horn that mysteriously just grows.
Yeah.
You know, because shrapnel often grows on its own in someone's head.
It's because it's symbolic. Good. Also, one thing about the Renegade Scars is it allows you to be as evil as possible and then fix it with credits, which is possibly the most evil solution to that problem.
It's the most Tory thing to do.
It is, because you can just like be like, oh well, this is like a billion, but now that I'm endgame, I'll just pay to remove my scars.
So basically, you just play as Elon Musk.
You can't. Well, sort of. If Elon Musk like was cool and actually got results out of anything and didn't just kill monkeys with brain chips
and electric cars.
And try and kill everyone on the roads. To this day, I will stay away from a Tesla if I can. I will change lanes to be like, I'm getting the hell out of here.
Just get like battle mode engaged. Get fuck what?
Well, and then the monkey with the brain chip comes out the top.
This is loads of monkeys just fucking running about.
Poor people detected.
How would they help with our galactic readiness? I'm not sure. But so once you get resurrected, like into, then you met with the voiceover of Miranda, and the old Jacob joins your little powwow.
Yeah,
I quite like Jacob, even though he's very misguided and like, but he's like one of those. He's like a sweet summer child sort of character where you're like, oh, Jacob, man, just stick with me and I'll train you up to...
I'll show you how to dig it properly.
Do you remember, like...
You'll be an N7 in no time.
Do you remember, like, the controversy, I guess, about him? Because he would, like, flirt with you. So all the 2012 or whatever gamers were like, hey, man, I'm not fucking gay. Like, he's chatting us up, like... It was like... It's like, of course, like, you know, you do the same to the women characters where, like, you know, like all the stupid gamers are picking all like the grossest options every time, the ones that are in the bottom right CD corner.
Oh, God, it's so like gamers to be offended that a mythical artificial character is chatting their mythical artificial character up and they are getting offended by it.
It's a friggin' compliment, man. You're seeing Jacob, he's jacked. I mean, he kind of skipped leg day, but like, dude's got a heart of gold. I liked having my little flirty banter with him every time we went in, and then he'd be like, I'm sorry, man. I don't want to talk about it right now afterwards. Like, I don't want to talk about my dead dad anymore.
Yeah, we're man. Open up.
Hey, Shepard, you got nice arms. Sorry, I don't want to talk about it right now. Okay.
Worms if we talked about my arms some more and then your dad. Is that okay?
That's my king, Commander.
I should go. and obviously there's Martin Sheen shows up.
The elusive. Can we just take a moment, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Is space cigarette.
Can we take a moment to appreciate three things about the elusive man?
Yeah.
One, the bitch-tastic theme.
Yeah.
I will have that, right? If I am doing something serious for work, I will have the Elusive Man theme or the Galaxy Map, but it's mostly the Elusive Man theme.
Oh, yeah.
And Goodwill now is funny because you ring, like, shining off your glasses, you've got the same sort of eyes as him.
Oh, no, God, no. I.
Shepherd.
His cyber eyes.
So, number one, the music. Number two, his fucking dress sense.
Oh, got some drip.
Sharp.
Got some drip.
Absolute. On fleek, this fella, right? And thirdly, his office.
Oh, yeah.
Just the nebula in the background constantly.
Black tiles and a sun.
Yeah.
That's it. Nail fucking light bulbs, black tiles, sun. And just sat there, cross-legged with a cigarette. I wish I could pull off smoking a cigarette as sexily as he does.
And he's
it's
like...
Martin Sheen.
He's the only guy that you see smoke as well, and he sort of positions himself as, like, you know, smartest guy in the universe, one step ahead of everybody, and it's just like, oh, like, I kind of hate you because, like, I'm Shepard, I don't want a boss, but all at the same time I'm like, maybe I do need someone I can go to, like, you know, to like chat about things. It's like, it's a really good, like, dichotomy where you're like, I know I should hate this guy, but maybe he's got some points. And then later on, you realize he doesn't have any good points. Yeah. But,
There was a good bit, a canon story about him and about, like, what his motives were. And I wish it was official. I'm trying to get it up here because it was just really fucking good.
Because the position Cerberus is like a good for the galaxy type of thing. But then it's interesting because other characters in that very same game are like, oh, you've joined Cerberus, like the human racist faction, and you're like, well, I guess now that you mention it, like, I haven't seen a lot of other races in the crew so far.
So there was a comic, that was it, there was a comic called Mass Effect Evolution. Before founding Cerberus, the elusive man was known as Jack Harper, a mercenary and part of a special group under the command of General Williams. During the First Contact War, Harper served aboard the Shanxi. And in later days of the war, he, Ben Hislop, and Eva Kaur were responsible for the capture of a Turian general named Desolus Arturius. After heading back to General Williams' command compound, he analysed the Turian troop movements and patterns and determined that they were looking for something. Upon interrogating and captured Turian, Jack discovered that Desolus was searching for an artifact. After capturing Desolus' forces, Jack questions Desolus further. Desolus merely tells Harper Harper to be careful about what he is looking for, as he might just find it. After leaving Eva in charge of the prisoners, Jack and Ben head out to the cave where the artifact is located. Basically, he is affected by the artifact, which is, I believe it's Prothean or Reaper in nature.
So he's like a twisted version of you, Shepard.
Yeah, and it's sort of... That's... In this, it sort of sets up what his motives were, and he's sort of like the anti-Shepherd.
Yeah.
And it really goes into the detail. It's a really good comic, and I would encourage anyone to, like, read it, but he has, like, a full manifesto of why he's doing it, and he genuinely believes, like, as we see in the games, that his intentions are honourable, are for the benefit of humanity as a whole. And
it sort
just...
of sounds like the Templars off Assassin's Creed.
He thoroughly believes, and that's what makes him a good villain as well. Mm-hmm. He believes his motives are completely and utterly justifiable, genuine, and honourable.
I am above the law.
And once they get into 3, then when you look back, you're also questioning, like, when did his indoctrination start? Because nobody's immune from that. But, like, out of, like, the new crop of characters, who did you like? Like, Goodwill, give us the crew rundown for the newbies in 2.
Okay, so bearing in mind that with Mass Effect 2, you had DLC crew members.
Include them. I had them all.
Yeah. Same here. So we have Kasumi Goto, which was the assassin.
Yeah. Grunt. Mission. Oh, I liked Grunt.
Grunt, yeah.
Thane Krios, who I loved.
Oh, Thane.
Jack.
Yep.
Miranda Lawson. Legion.
Oh, hell yeah.
Legion, great.
Zaid Messani, who had the shittest accent in the known universe.
Yeah.
Talzara. All right, am I South African or am I Cockney? I'll leave it to you to decide. Talizari Vasnima, Samara, Morinith.
And I was never good enough to get the Morinith thing happening.
The one character that everybody loved, Morden Solus.
Oh,
yeah.
Jacob Taylor, Garrus, and Liara Tassoni.
Yeah. You know, on my first playthrough, I didn't like Morden as much because I was like, you suck. Like, you ruined Rex's race, like, completely. So I gave him, like, a hard time the entire time. I was like, you know, like fuck you, Morden, you weird... Like, what would you even
really
call
were
that?
A renegade, weren't you?
Fuck yeah, I know. Well, fair enough. He liked show tunes, but he was like way too into, I don't know, euthanasia. What'd you call that? I can't remember. What
genocide.
Yeah.
Every time someone says that, I think my brain goes, the youth in Asia.
That's like, not I'm what, like, he, what. That's not who he was killing. He was making all the Krogans infertile.
I have visions of Adam just sat watching all these films and going, what is it with killing kids in Asia? What are they? Leave them alone.
The damn Tories. Why do they keep wanting to do it?
Bloody Cameron.
Grunt was weird because they were like, he's a pure Krogan. And like, but he was like a baby man. Like, he didn't know anything about the world because he just... You birthed him, basically. And he was like, father, headbutt me to gain superiority. Whatever you had to do. But also, like, you could leave him shut in his tube, right? Like, that was an option. I don't think many people would have did it.
Hmm.
You could, but you wouldn't get a good
idea. I always wanted
him
on my side, like, to be fighting.
You know, like, I've always got a soft spot for when the bad guys turn to, like, the good side, like with Legion, where it's like, you know, I was like, you know what? I didn't really know anything about your race. Like, what were they called again? Sorry, like the techno people. Legions.
Ooh. Legion
the
is...
bad guys.
He is a Geth.
Geth.
Yes, I think Geth.
I was like...
Cybernetic Goth.
I was like, I've obviously shot a lot of you guys, but I didn't actually know why I was shooting you.
I've killed a lot of you, but I don't know
definitely why. In the first one. But yeah, like, when he gets to talk and it's like a super, like, detached, like, he's like a multi-consciousness, like a hive mind, kind of. But he's sort of, like, separated a bit, isn't he? Like, he knows all of the Geth, like, information, but he's not, like, actively... relaying everything you say to the guest.
He is the Hue of Mass Effect. Mm-hmm. That's what he's based on.
Oh, okay. But I did like him. He was always on my team as the tech guy because I was more of a biotics guy, shotgun man, lady. Sorry.
Yeah, shotgun man, lady.
Yeah. And yeah, you know, Samara, I liked going to chat to her, but I rarely took her on missions. But I liked hearing her, like, you know, uppity stories and stuff. Yeah. I quite like Jack as well because I was like, yeah, I'm gonna take like the scrappy young upstart with me.
I because obviously you had to take them on a certain set amount of missions to unlock their loyalty mission.
Oh yeah.
Very important. For me, it was always Garrus, Miranda, or Solus and Miranda.
Okay.
Because I liked Morden, but Garrus was just the heavy hitter for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, and Thane, he was interesting. Very depressed, though.
I'm dying, Shepard. I'm dying, Shepard.
Yeah, it was interesting. He had an awesome voice as well, like a really like deep one. But yeah, like
he had about 40 a day with that voice.
I'm dying, Shepard.
Yeah, but yeah, like
a weird filter over the top that made him sound like he was underwater, but not.
Yeah, a little bit.
Well, yeah, because he had gills, didn't he? Yeah.
And you could like, I'm sure there was a moment where he was like, "Are you trying to ask about my gills?" You know, like trying.
Let's not forget who played his son.
I don't remember.
Raiden from MGS2. Quentin Flynn.
It's me. I'm Thane's son. What day is today?
Can I be the main character? No, you are again relegated to the beta.
And you kind of look exactly the same as a different character. But yeah, like Adam, like who did you kind of like gravitate towards into? Because I definitely spent a lot more time with Garrus, I think, because there was more like conversations and stuff you could get in there. I think I tried to like cozy up to Jack a bit, but she was obviously like angry a lot of the time.
Yeah, I mean, I gravitated towards my two favorite people into, which were Garrus and Miranda.
Yeah,
that's a good solid team there, especially because I think you played Soldier, didn't you?
I'll always Soldier because I don't know why I've like when I've been doing like playthroughs recently in the last few years anyway, I've gone more towards Biotix and like the technical side more. But yeah, well, on the first playthroughs, it was definitely Soldier because I was good at shooters, so I thought I might as well stick to the shooty.
I liked having the biotic powers, but it did mean that I usually had to use pistols a lot of the time, which I wasn't super like hot on, but like the combat was almost like secondary or like even less than that priorities rise. How did the suicide mission go for you guys? Because I think I can fairly accurately recount mine to a certain extent. I had a lot of casualties in this one, guys, I'm not gonna lie, because I just went with my no looking ahead, just went in there and did what I thought was right. So Legion immediately dies because I put him in that tube and he gets like shot in the head while the doors are closing. The one where you have to show someone, you have to like make someone do a biotic shield around your party.
Yeah,
that was awesome because Samara was just like, I can do it, like, you know, fuck off, like, this is, like, child's play to me. And I was like, no, Jack, like, I believe in you. And she, like, hesitantly, like, walks up to do it, and then you get this, like, awesome moment where she, like, pulls it off, and she doesn't, like, think she can, but, like, you believed in her. It's like, that was awesome. And then I think when you split the party, I sent Morden and Grunt to save the hostages. Oh, by the way, the crew got melted. I didn't get there fast enough, also. I was busy doing Legion's loyalty quest, you know, cause it was very important, considering he died within, like, 20 minutes. The crew got liquidated, apart from Kelly.
Mass Effect 3 must have been very quiet for you. That's all I'm going to say.
I'll explain a little bit why it wasn't quiet. Okay, yeah, we did that. I sent Grunt and Morden back to take, like, to protect the ship. Morden didn't make that that one. Grunt survived, and I think I just took, like, I think I left, like, you know, a bunch of normal-ish people like Garrus and everyone to like hold the line. They were fine. And whoever
hold the line.
And whoever you take into the boss battle survives no matter what. So yeah, like, I lost a few, so that suicide mission felt like it actually had, like, we didn't pull it off. We pulled it off, but like, it really was a suicide mission for some of those guys. But yeah, can you guys remember how yours went at all, Adam?
The first time through, mine was just as bad as yours, Jake. not gonna lie, it was just I was literally nearly in. I'm like, oh boy, come on, this way. And all these people are dying.
And you have, like, to fight a baby Terminator, all sad.
Yeah, I was just like, oh man. But then I went and did a playthrough again And I didn't look anything up because I wasn't into doing that. I was like, I wanted, like, so I just did like everybody's loyalty mission and got what I wanted from it.
It didn't always help though, because there was some choices that are just right and wrong for like those parts.
Yeah. And then the second time through, I think Jack died on mine.
Oh, that's a shame. She turns it all around, you know. She has a band of kids that she looks after in the third one.
So Jack died, and who else? I think Thane on me second go through.
I think I might have lost Thane, you know, thinking about it. I don't remember him being in three. Oh, thank you for the raid, Mix Sources Studio. I think you did that last time, and I maybe forgot to thank you, but thank you very much.
Thanks.
Yeah, I think I might have lost Thane as well in the sort of, like, leave three guys at the end to, like, hold the position. But yeah, Goodwill, can you remember what your, like, first suicide mission was like?
Oh, God, he's got PTSD in my look.
I mean, it was 12 years ago. Not well, that's what I'm going to say. I think five died.
Wow.
I think it was Samara.
Okay.
Legion. Jack. Thane. Morden, I believe.
Yeah, he's too squishy to go out on his own.
Yeah. But I had not really, because this was my first time playing like a proper RPG.
I don't think there's been before or since a mission like this. Like, you know, where you're actually sitting there being like, holy shit, like, I've actually got to make life or death decisions with this crew.
Horizon Zero Dawn sort of had a similar thing.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, the most beautiful world in gaming told through the most boring character. But it was...
I can agree with that. Yeah, definitely.
Because this is why I went back and played it again. But I played it from the beginning, and I was like, I am going to do every fucking mission, side mission, little quest, listen to everything, read everything before I do the suicide mission. Because let's not forget, this was a game where it's just like, you can go through the Omega 4 relay now if you want. 20 minutes into the game.
Yeah.
You can do it now if you want.
Yeah, you can do it now.
But if you don't, get the ship upgrades, people can die on the cutscene into the mission, because like they'll blow up like the side of the ship, and it'll be like, no, before we're even in there. Oh, sorry, the Doctor Chakwas lives. That's who you rescue out of the two, basically.
Dr. Chakwas.
She's the only one who doesn't get liquidated ever, no matter how long you leave it.
Hello, Shepard. Do you remember our times on the SR-1? I remember being shot out of it into an orbit. But
let's get drunk, lady.
With your fancy whatever it is, like alcohol that you'd had saved up or something.
Oh, you've always got to buy that for her. If you don't, you're
every monster. Doctor's got a booze cabinet. That's what I learned from sci-fi.
But yeah, like, I think the reason mine is like burned into my memory is because I never like went back and did it again. Like, I've done it once now, like with a different Shepard, like maybe a couple of years ago.
But how many times have you played?
I've played them all a few times, but I've only like done one singular, like all the way through. So like I've got a canonical playthrough in me. So like what I'll tell you about three, if you guys never like imported the save to three, disappointingly just replace everybody with stand-in characters. Like you get Morden's like partner, who was also on the same Genophage like science mission, and he does the whole like death thing the same way Morden does, but less you know, gravitas, because it's not anyone you care about, but he does the exact same go up in the elevator thing.
Imagine being the voice actor for that character, no one ever knowing you were ever there, because everyone just transported the saves over.
But it's not, like I say, it's not that different. A Legion just inexplicably is resurrected, like, as a different, like, body, if you know what I mean? Because he's, like...
Oh, so he's, like, downloaded into something else.
Yeah, he's got, like, half a digital face sort of thing. It's, like, what? it's only slightly different. So I sided with him, because I was like, Legion, you're back. I'm sorry I killed you.
My boy!
No, Tally. What? I'm not sure. Like I say, I don't know if anything happens with Thane. Maybe his son does show up if you...
Raiden.
Yeah.
In the MGS2 sneak suit.
And he talks about how he's only got like one poster and a chair in his room. And he watches King Kong all night. Yeah. So yeah, like disappointingly, they sort of just replace people with like generic stand-ins.
Can I just ask, Samara's loyalty mission, how much did it piss you off?
It was, I just remember being quite confused by the whole thing, because it's like we're trying to find our daughter, and our daughter seems pretty cool, and then like you were mentioning before, there is, if you're like high enough level at that time, you can basically make her like replace her mother, but it just, they don't really change our voice acting or anything after that. It's weird.
Only part of the game I needed a guide for.
Because it basically makes almost no sense.
it doesn't, and I mean, even to this day, like I must have played Mass Effect 2 15 times, and even now I'm just like, do I choose that? I still can't play it.
Yeah.
And I still need a guide for it, and it's just, it was an awful loyalty mission. Out of all the games, that is the worst loyalty mission.
And she was quite an interesting character. Very, very different from Liara. So you got like a different side of like Asari culture. And like I say, she has cool conversations when you sit in like a galaxy room where she just looks out to space. Zaid, he didn't have much to say. Like, all of the DLC characters, like, you couldn't actually have conversations with them. You would just click on them and get like one line. It wasn't like a conversation.
You could with Kasumi, but it was very, very few and far in between. So, Zaid would be on one side of the ship, in his little fucking
junk room.
Cupboard, in his cupboard, where Christopher Pike is stored. Beep. And Kasumi was in the crew lounge, because every military stealth ship needs a bar, and
that only she's allowed to be
in. That only she's allowed in. And I would say the whole game there was like two direct cutscenes where you could interact with her, because she would then move and look at the window.
I think what would happen is you could click on stuff in their room and they would tell you like a story about it. Like Zaid, you'd be like, "That's my favorite gun that is on the wall there."
Beanbags, mate.
Also, can we give a shout out to Trisha Heffer, who is Edie?
Yes, I forgot about Edie, because she's not a crew member until 3.
But they do. I mean, I love the Norman B. I love the SR2 over the SR1. And they do address like certain actual real world things, because I think when Shepard's walking around the ship and he's talking to Edie and he's like, "I don't like a ship with windows," and she's like, "Ah, well, we thought about this because every window's got a blast door." Because he's like, "Oh, it's a structural vulnerability," and I'm like,
"Yeah,
it kind of is to have all these fucking windows."
And then they talk about how there's like how the messages are encrypted with some kind of like quantum computing and stuff like that. Like, I love like that they've sat and thought about that. I don't have to understand it, but it sounds cool.
Sounds spacey.
But yeah, like when you finally like got to 3, and me and Adam, like, we went to like Asda at midnight, you know, like lads do with a car, first car. And got our copies, and then went our separate ways so we could both play it. I reversed the cover first, obviously, because this was the first one where you had a reversible Femme Shep cover. But yeah, I was kind of disappointed in 3 because it felt very weird. And I think I was a bit too close to the series because I loved 2 so much. That when 3 came out and certain things weren't what I was expecting, like, I was saying the Rachni Queen, I saved her. Then you find out that it doesn't actually matter. Like, they don't side with you. They get like taken over by like the Reaper juice and go all black tar heroin, like like all the other races. And it's like, oh well, it didn't really matter then. And I think I looked it up afterwards, and I was like, no, like that choice didn't matter. And I think And I think that choice kills Grunt as well. Like, he just jumps off into the hole, and you're like, well, I liked you as well. So there was a lot of moments that just left a bad taste in my mouth. Like, and the ending, I didn't really like at all. Like, I don't know, how did you guys feel about it?
I think with 3, I think it's supposed to make you feel that way. I know that's a weird flip from BioWare, but it's like, it's supposed to make you feel like you actually are, like, fighting the war for, like, all of humanity.
And, like, it's gone out of your control, basically.
Yeah. Like, as Goodwill was saying, like, where everything was going wrong for him.
Yeah.
In 3, it's like, I think it's meant to be that way to give you that, like, you do get that little to hope towards the end. You're like, oh, we're actually fucking doing something here. Like, when you finally get your fleet up to, like, the maximum can be. To, like, push into the final battle, you're like, go on, we can actually do this now. And then there's some curveballs after that as well. So
I mean,
like,
kind of. But that was the problem with the ending for me, though. Because obviously you have the moment where you tell the elusive man to, like, get fucked and that he's a crazy old coot. But after that, you're kind of on your own. And I'm like, where's my crew? Like, I'm just listening to, like, the AI child talk to me about the end of the world, and I'm just like, I guess I'll make these 1 of 3 choices. I picked synthesis the first time.
1 of 2.
What?
Before you would get in there, it was only 2 before they patched it.
Oh, really? I think I must have played enough.
Don't you remember the great controversy?
Well, yeah, I remember the added new cutscenes, but I think I played it. I definitely had the 3 choices because it was basically like red, blue, and middle.
So this was, and at the time, this was huge. It was a massive 12 gigabyte update for the game. Now, on like 360 PS5, that's like fucking hell, that's like massive. Or was it? No, something like 8 gigabytes or something like that. It was big.
Yeah.
Because the original game, it had a few issues. The original Mass Effect 3 had a few issues where some decisions. When I said, like, the first time I played it, it felt like I was losing all the way through. It was because of the way that they designed the game. And then when you got to the ending, and I remember this vividly, I'd got to the ending, I was feisty as fuck. I was about 17 stone heavier on Pringles and Relentless. And you get, like, at that point, you'd been playing 14 hours nonstop. You'd, like Adam said, you built up the fleet. You've done everything you can.
It was a long last mission as well. Like,
it was very long because you're fighting through London. You're fighting through wreckage and everything like that. I hadn't fully explored everything because I felt, and I know this was wrong, but I felt like everything you did in the game was done in real time, and the longer you left stuff, the worse the Reapers would take over, because every time you went to the galaxy map, more and more stuff had been taken over.
Yeah, yeah.
And the followers like, galaxy map, don't they?
Yeah, yeah. So I sat down, I'm like, oh shit, I can't go there anymore. Oh God, I can't go there. I'm going to have to rush. I'm going to have to do this. And you fight through this mission, and it is a long-ass mission. And you are, as a gamer, at hour 40, you are drained emotionally from it. And then at the end, you get those 2 choices. And it's either AI dies, or what was it? You get merged with...
I think because Sarah's saying there's a 4th choice. So I think what happened was there was 3 choices at the start, and they added a 4th one where you could talk the AI boy into, like, killing himself or something.
There wasn't 4. Surely there wasn't.
But
I'm pretty sure there was 3.
From what I remember, synthesis was in the middle column of light. Yeah, and then there was like a red and a blue choice. And, like, it was like destroy the Reapers. I can't remember what the blue one was.
It was actually called, this is how much shit BioWare got. It was called Mass Effect 3 The Extended Cut, and it was free DLC.
Yeah. Okay, so Joe's saying that there was 3 in the original, 4 was added, which was like a nothing choice, like, I don't want to choose any of these. There was control, which was pegged as the blue choice, and destruction was pegged as the red choice. But did you hear the the thing where they were saying that's like the Reapers getting in your mind, being like, it is Renegade to destroy us, but it is Paragon to control us, which is like backwards when you think about it. Like, the taking over the AI minds doesn't sound good. Yeah, so everyone's saying,
yeah, the two extra endings were added in the extended cut because it was control and destruction. So control was basically you control the Reapers,
yeah,
and then destruction was you destroy the Reapers, but all tech. AI,
yeah,
and all tech gets dies. Tech dies,
including the mass relays,
and the SR2 crashes into a planet, and then you get that really weird cut scene of a child and a father in the snow. Honestly, like, I'm looking at the...
Oh, God, I tell me about the tale of the shepherd. I forgot about that. Actual synthesis, which I thought was a good thing at the time. And then I was like, oh, I'm dead. Like, I'm all the Reapers now. And then when I saw the Normandy crash, like, I was sad. I was like, oh, shit, I've killed everybody. And then I was happy to see like Joker and Edie pop out at the end with the weird green lines that were drawn on them.
I'm really curious now because I've played the games and I've never had walk away. I didn't know if it was a choice to walk away, and I've like,
that was new. Like, that wasn't in the game when I played it. But I don't know what happens. But I do know that they added more cutscenes. So like we got the crash cut ending where it's like, I don't know, you fucked, it's over, bye, mass relays are dead, Shepard's dead, goodbye everybody.
Because at the end, because they were like, because the original ending, because I played it when it came out, and it was just like two choices, and
what did you pick though, like
control?
Okay, the evil choice in my mind,
because I was like, well, I don't want AI to die.
Yeah.
And like, what am I like? What? Like, it was very, I think a lot of people were pissed off because they were like, we've done these games for like 5 years, and you just give us these two at the time shit endings.
Yeah. We didn't. I don't think anyone wanted to destroy the Mass Effect universe, which was kind of what all the choices led to.
But this was because people were like, obviously it's a trilogy, but then people are like, but these, we want this universe to continue, and how can it possibly continue when you've got one where Shepard's not there and the Reapers are in control, and then one where all AI dies, like,
and the mass relays are broke, so you can't,
and the mass relays are broken. So the whole point, so it would just be effect, because there'd be nothing there to travel with. So I think a lot of people were rightly pissed off, and I chose, when the patch did, I chose synthesis.
Yeah.
But again, I didn't really...
It doesn't feel good. They don't make it look feel good afterwards.
Well, then when you look at the trailers for Mass Effect 5, you don't see people's faces much. And what you do see, they're in helmets and everything like that, but you don't see green lines. So I'm like...
Which end is canon?
And that's, everyone wants to know what ending is this. It's the same, I'll tell you what it is. It's the same for the Metal Gear Solid series after the choice in Metal Gear 1.
Yeah.
And then all the way through, they were like, yeah, that's cool, but what choice did he make? And then we don't get an answer until Metal Gear 4, where it's like, oh, this is actually the canon story.
Yeah, they did keep that information from us for a long time.
For 10 years. Yeah. But for me, it was like I said, it felt like a losing battle. I mean, that's how it was supposed to feel, but like before they patched it, it genuinely felt like a losing battle, that everyone was dying and the world was coming to an end. And this is why the dreams were so vivid that I was having at the time, because you're playing through this and you're like, I'm fucking this up.
Yeah.
And then you just get these two choices and you're just like,
Yeah, I just didn't know what to do.
And then the SR2 crashes. Yeah, and then the SR2 crashes and you're just like, So basically, you're dead, the crew are dead, and there's a random gadget on a snowfield talking to his kid.
Yeah, and like, I just don't know what... It was almost as if they were like destroying their own franchise, so nobody could like make any more games.
Yeah.
I just don't really know what they were thinking, because I don't think anyone was really happy with it. The the extended cutscenes make it make more sense. But even then, you're still stuck with the same outcomes. Yeah. Like I say, I don't know what the do nothing does exactly, but I can't imagine.
I'm going to look for this now because I'm really interested.
Solves it, though, when you think about it.
I've never actually heard of this. And, you know, I've played the game since it came out.
The DLC was an absolute mess. I was talking to Adam the other day about this because they had DLC only if you bought it new, which was a Prothean crew member, which is it's very important to the story that the Protheans were like an extinct race.
But this was at a time where gaming, where it was like, if this is a used game, you can not purchase anything because EA were scumbags.
Yeah, they were trying to make you pay like £10 if you bought it secondhand to be like, because that's an important crew member, right? Like, what's he called? Yeah. Like, Jace or something like that. I don't know.
Hello, primitives.
He was a bastard, like, but he was interesting to talk to.
But he had a really, like, you could sort of understand why he was a bastard.
Kind of, yeah. But yeah, also, there was the DLC called Leviathan, where you talk to a fully organic Reaper.
Jarvik.
Sarah's helping us out here. The Leviathan wasn't available when I played the game, so I've only watched that after the fact. And that is an incredibly interesting conversation you have with an organic Reaper. And I'm just like, oh, it was an absolute mess. Because what did they expect? Like, did they expect super fans to not play it on release day? Like, I have no idea what they were thinking, apart from it seems like they ran out of time.
So I've just read about the ending about do nothing. If you refuse a Catalyst 6,
the centrist ending.
Yeah, the crucible shuts off. Then it fast forwards into the future of a beacon and Liara, just like the Protheans in 6, telling whatever future generations about what had transpired in the past.
So she basically is like the last surviving, like. Voice of our like generation.
The ending is dubbed refusal. So you can get there by refusing all three options, taking too long to decide, or shooting the ghost kid.
I'd heard about shooting the kid, but that's nuts though, because taking too long to decide, like, you, that's a big decision. Like, I stood there for a long time, if I remember right.
That's very Far Cry 4.
Yeah.
Where you can just finish the game in 15 minutes by just doing nothing.
Sit on the couch.
that's really interesting. But it also poses a question for Mass Effect 5. What ending... Because my theory for Mass Effect 5 is it's going to be in the far future.
Yeah.
I thought they'd been hinting like it was Liara, though.
Well, yeah. Liara is only 100 years old in Mass Effect 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
So she lives till 1,000. So, well, and, you know, she could be the age of Samara by the time Mass Effect 5.
Okay.
But it's really interesting to see what ending they choose from that, whether they do synthesis, control, destruction, or just shoot the kid in the head.
I'm just thinking about this. I don't know if I can think of another situation of people writing themselves into a corner this badly.
Yeah.
I think it was very. They wanted to do 3 and done, and Electronic Arts was like, no.
Yeah. So do you think they like tanked it a little bit on purpose? Be like, try and follow this one, guys.
But then we got Andromeda.
Yeah. Yes. Which I didn't play, but I've seen plenty of footage of.
Should we talk more about Mass Effect 3 before we get into that? Because I've got some interesting views on Andromeda.
I don't know, like, Adam, have you got anything that jumps out to you about 3 or the entire journey as a whole, I guess, now?
With 3, I did enjoy the game as a whole, but as I say, as you've mentioned with the endings there, it was just a bit like, oh, I've put that many hours in for just those decisions.
I think I maybe shed a tear, like, when the Normandy goes down and I'm like, oh, I've killed everybody. Like, fuck, I picked the wrong choice. I think I've done a replay of 3 and checked out that DLC stuff. Because there's the one where you go, like, you have a party with everyone on the Citadel. Yes,
that is my favorite.
That's nice. Great. Yeah.
That is. I leave that deliberately until the last mission.
Yeah.
Because it feels more poignant when you do that, because it's lighthearted, it's fun, the other party. But then there's a scene where Shepard's just looking at the SR2 and he's just like, I feel like this is the last time we're going to see everybody and everyone, you know. And it just resonates a lot more.
Yeah.
But it's fun. And it's like, it doesn't introduce more jeopardy or anything like that. It's just like, woo, we're having shenanigans on the Citadel.
And I think more games need to do that, where it's like, In more movies as well, like, not everything has to be like action, small chat, love scene, action. Yeah. Like, you need to see characters like enjoying themselves.
Yeah.
It humanizes everybody and then makes you care more when things get bad again. Mm. But yeah, like, I think in my mind, that's kind of like, let's just have that be the end. And
that's the dance.
Oh, I didn't get the gif of that. I got the gif of this, though.
Deal with it, Ashley, you racist.
But yeah, like, I don't know. Like, Adam, did you play Andromeda? Do you have any feelings on Andromeda? Because I sure don't.
I still haven't completed it. I don't know how far I got through, but there's at one point where I was just like, I'd rather go and play the original three again. Yes, like, parts about it were great. I mean, it had Clancy Brown in it.
Yep.
Yes, yeah.
But yeah, there was certain things about it that were just haunted.
I've seen some screenshots and GIFs of crew members floating around and typing on keyboards that aren't there.
This is where they just
go
like...
yeah, and Ryder's faces sometimes.
This was at a time where Electronic Arts were like, oh, you've got a great game. Oh, it looks actually really good. Yeah, rip it out and put it in Frostbite 3. Oh, that's also a great game as well. Oh, it's a racing game. Put it in Frostbite 3. No, everything runs on Frostbite 3.
Yep.
So then they moved Mass Effect into Frostbite and it just looked fucking horrendous. Mm-hmm. Because BioWare were limited by Electronic Arts by using fucking Frostbite. So every game of 2010 all the way to 2018 was fucking Frostbite, and it was disgusting.
Was that the Battlefield engine?
That was the Battlefield engine, because they were like, ooh, it's robust to play a Battlefield, so it must be good for everything. And it's like, no.
Yeah.
So you don't use a FIFA engine for Formula One, you Doyle, because it's a different game. It was... The engine, because it's really interesting, Andromeda, and I'm probably going to get some flack. I liked it because it had that potential there to start a new trilogy and the DLC and everything like that. But this was at a point where Electronic Arts were getting so involved unnecessarily and making decisions unnecessarily that deliberately ran the game into the ground. So they were like I said, they built Mass Effect Andromeda in a separate engine, and it was fine, and there was no issues. But then Electronic Arts were like, oh, we need to cut costs down, so it's Frostbite. And the developers were like, but Frostbite does not work with this game. It will be poorly optimized to run Frostbite.
Frostbite.
Yeah, and that's what it was. Yeah, but that's what it was. They're like, everything else is working in Frostbite. Why can't your game work? If this can't work in Frostbite, that's your fault.
Yeah, pretty much.
Not the fact that the engine is shit.
And it couldn't possibly work with a game that massive as well.
Exactly, yeah. So they moved it over, and that's why even like after launch there was a lot of graphical patches and everything like that, and even then there was still like really bad issues with it. That's why you get all the GIFs.
I think even now it's not fixed, as far as I'm aware.
No, it won't. They absolutely won't. It had an extremely interesting premise. They got around Mass Effect 3's ending perfectly, because they were like, this takes place after Mass Effect 1, Mass Effect 2, and then 700 years in the future.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where they've travelled so far, they've travelled into the Andromeda Galaxy, that standard transmissions will take hundreds and hundreds of years to get there.
And it, yeah, and it doesn't matter about mass relays because they don't have them over there.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then we're like, you know, oh, well, we can set beacons along the way, but it'll still take, even then it's like months or something like that. Yeah. To tell them that they're in the Andromeda Galaxy.
They do a bit of crappy like writing though, where they're like, oh, unfortunately, all the other races are trapped in cold storage, so you're not gonna see all your favorites, guys.
Well, again, they're like these are all the arcs, and this is the human one. This is the whatever race, and then they're like, oh, well, the Quarians are on this one and stuff like that. On the whole, because it improved on the ground vehicle mechanics.
Yes. The gameplay and the shooting and stuff looked fun. Like the jet boost stuff looked like it added like some fun elements.
Yeah, it improved on that so much. It was very Zelda temple-y on every bloody planet, where it was just like, oh, you've got to change this and go to this temple and do this on this planet.
You guys play Dragon Age Inquisition?
Yes.
No.
Because it had like, it's got the same map basically, where it fills in with a lot of stuff, a lot of like question marks and all that stuff, icons as you drive around.
Yeah.
Like, what did you was the story any good? Because like, I don't know a lot about how that game ends up. I've seen a bunch of footage. I heard it ends on a cliffhanger for DLC that they never delivered on, which is also bad.
It ended on, there was two endings for it that succeeded each other. So there was a cliffhanger ending for the main baddie. Essentially it was the same thing as Protheans and stuff like that, where it's just like, oh, ancient civilization's got this tech and this baddie's after it, and you're trying to stop him and stuff. So they had that, which was got to be a setup for a sequel, which is fine. And then, because obviously all the way through, there was other arcs still on the way, or other arcs that had gone missing. And then at the last bit, you hear distress signals for the Quarian arc, which has been trapped in an asteroid field, and you're like, that's the DLC.
And then that's the part that never happened.
Yeah, and even BioWare were like, yep, that's the DLC. So you could properly unite everyone.
Yeah.
But it was really interesting because they did it after the, so it was DLC for after the main story had ended.
Which isn't normally how you played Mass Effect. It would normally finish and then you'd do New Game Plus.
So you would, like, any DLC would happen before the last mission, so you are fully leveled up and you've got everyone there. This was like, no, this game has ended, now there's DLC, because then the DLC will link into Andromeda 2.
Yeah.
The reviews were so disappointing and the uptake in sales were so disappointing that EA just immediately shelved it, and they were like, it's your fault.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The footage was bad. Like, you know, it's one of those things where, like, when Bethesda games come out, there's a lot of, like, funny glitch videos, but when you watch, like, general games website coverage, the amount of glitches you will actually see if someone's just playing normally isn't that high in Bethesda. No. But in this game, it was almost like unavoidable. Like, anything like the games people tried to do, like, I could, like, there was a lot of them getting frustrated because they were like, we can't, like, this is like bad content because, like, the game is just acting weird. It's like embarrassing.
There was a point in the story where you would literally not be able to progress off the station because the system would crash. So I had to wait nearly 2 weeks for BioWare to knock out a patch so I could finish the game.
I'm just imagining you sat there in front of your computer like stone faced, like,
it was, I tried every single, well, originally they were like, oh, it's your hard drive that's causing the issue.
And how dare, like, you?
But then people were like, well, it can't be the hard drive because most people's PS4s don't have stock hard drives. People have modified it, increased, put solid state in it and everything like that. And they asked, at the time I had a 2 terabyte in my hard drive. And I'm like, well,
rolling over here.
Well, I was like, so why am I having the issue? Why is this person having an issue with a solid state drive?
Yeah.
So then that excuse got thrown out, and then they're like, oh yeah, it's an actual progression bug. Yeah. And it's like, you are a multi-billion dollar company that has released a game that's got a game crashing bug, which means that no one can play your game.
Yeah.
And then the reviews just got, it just tanked the reviews.
Yeah, I mean, there was no way I could see myself persevering through that, because I was watching videos from people I trusted who were like, this is like bad even for like,
yeah,
video game standards. Lee's asking in the chat, was it worse than Cyberpunk? I think so. I'm pretty sure.
I loved Cyberpunk even with the glitches. Yeah.
Cyberpunk is a different kettle of fish, because
they were like coming in super hot with a lot of heady promises about what their game was going to be.
They were over promising for the technology that the mass public had, where they were like, well, you need to have a high end gaming PC, but here it is on the PS4, and it's just like, a 10-year-old games console is not going to be able to run game optimized for 40.
It's like CD Projekt Red, have you seen the stats on Steam about how most people still have like 970s? Like, get with the program, dudes.
Yeah.
But like, it's an absolute shame that like Mass Effect had to like end on Andromeda. But there is no way I would ever tell anyone not to play the Mass Effect trilogy. Yep. Like, there's nothing in those games that I would even like warn people about. Like, possibly just like the combat in one is not really what you used to, because I don't think there wasn't really any games like that at the time. Driving the Mako was a bit like how Halo's driving worked, so that had precedent.
It was the repetitive outpost. I mean, like, so yeah, driving the Mako was fine. It was just the outpost for a bit.
If I can give you advice, like, mainline the story in one. Like, you'll find all the side quests on the Citadel, but like, you can tell which are the important ones and which ones aren't so much, because it kind of points you in the direction of the important stuff, and the weirder side quests are actually quite hard to find a lot of the times, because the map wasn't great in the first one. Two, I would say do everything, because like, that's all, most of that stuff apart from the repeatable bases was excellent, but you need the resources to upgrade, so worth it.
Sarah's just mentioned a comment there. I personally never experienced the Andromeda or Cyberpunk bugs, which is what she's referring to, but I do think Andromeda got a harder time over it.
Oh, okay.
I disagree. I think Cyberpunk got a way harder time over it, because they really overpromised with it. Mm-hmm. And they openly admitted, like, after the game came out, where they were like, oh yeah, all the gameplay and promotion and stuff, it's all been on high-end £4,000-£6,000 PCs that like three people in the world have,
and they were making their staff like work hellish overtime just to get the broken version out, which is like, nobody's going to be happy with that. Sarah's saying the most important side quest is to buy the auto feeder for your fish in Mass Effect.
Yeah. Every single time, get that auto feeder in Mass Effect 2.
I think the hamster's indestructible though, right?
Oh yeah.
Or Kelly Yeoman Chambers says she'll look after your hamster, and you're like, go get it, girl. Want to meet later for chess and a shower? Because that's what happens on your last date with her. Chess and a communal shower. That's the shepherd promise. Oh, but yeah, like, that's the thing. I didn't want to, as the Mass Effect series, I didn't want to end the podcast on Andromeda. So like guys, like, what was like your favorite moment in the game? Like, absolute favorite moment that like trumps everything else. I think for me, it was definitely like, I guess a happy moment, I would say, was definitely the Citadel DLC party, where you just get to hang out with everyone and chat. A highlight, like, emotionally, was definitely like my suicide mission, where like, I lost guys, but we got through it, and I told the elusive man to go fuck himself at the end of the game. And I was like, hell yeah, we ended that strong, slightly damaged. Like, you know, we're a little bit worse off in some ways, we're a little bit better off in other ways, but that was probably one of the most like strongest emotional connections I'd had. And even though it was a bit sad, like it's still up there with like big moments for me.
Yeah. For me, I'd say definitely the party one, because it gave you that like feeling of family.
Yeah.
Like massively. But then you get that, like towards the end of that bit, you like get the realization, you're like, oh, there's always something really nice happens. Something bad happens in games usually.
Yeah, and you're movies, like, yeah.
Oh, you're like, yeah, this is gonna go wrong, but and I'd say another moment for me, that I really liked, and it was quite sad as well, was what's the assassin's name again? I remember.
Thin.
No, the other one. The girl.
Oh, Kasumi.
Yes. Her loyalty mission in the DLC.
Okay, like the spy party thing that you've
got. Yeah. Oh, that was good, that.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And then she gets what she's looking for, and it's basically it's like a black box of memories.
Yes, yeah, and that's right, yeah.
It's quite sad when you like you get the end of that.
Oh, I think you're cutting out slightly there, Adam. Oh. But yeah, like it's you're right, like she comes off very like standoffish and like cooler than you. But
yeah,
then she finally breaks down.
Yeah, it's quite sad really, because she's like, yeah, she becomes a lot like, because she was like this really mysterious, like sort of stealthy character, and then she's like totally like totemotes like.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, good. Well, hit us with the top moment or moments.
Oh, top moments. Suicide mission. Curing the genophage.
That was nice that you got to do that, yeah.
The ultimate redemption of Morden Solus and his evil ways.
Or Borden Bolus, as I got in my Last Effect 3. Gordon's show miss, yeah.
But I think I think, and a lot of people will probably agree, it's the Citadel DLC, because it's like the moment before you go over the top.
Yeah, and it really goes over the top.
and it really does, because it's like that, and I'll say it again, it's that scene where he's just leaning on the bars looking at the ship, and it's that realization they might not all come back from this
again.
But it's like, it's serious, and it's sort of, if you've never played the game and you've done that DLC and you go into this final mission, I wonder how much of an effect it would have to have that like crushing realization that this is literally the game changer mission. Yeah. This is it. This is what you have worked for all three games, and there is zero guarantee that anyone is coming back, no matter how much you rank them up or do the loyalty or anything like that. There is no guarantee, because it is the final game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The final mission of Mass Effect 3, because it is just long, arduous, and it drains you, so you feel like Shepard feels, where they are just drained from battle, they are drained from it all, and it hits differently. Yes, we get rid of the elusive man.
Yeah.
But to see the Admiral there as well.
Oh, yeah, I forgot he popped up at the end.
Admiral Hackett. And it just, it hits. It
Keith
really
motherfucking
does hit
David
you.
For anyone who doesn't know.
Yeah, man. Shout out to Claudia Black, who was in this game as well. Marina Sirtis, and basically anyone from Star Trek. But it was, it's very, everyone goes on about the suicide mission, and that's fine. But I think that's just, that is a final mission.
Yeah.
And I think they pulled it off brilliantly, bar the ending.
Yes.
Yeah. But like it's just a series full of like absolutely incredible moments. If you hit them like first time and you haven't like been spoiled on things. So sorry if we've spoiled anything for you guys.
Oopsie.
But Yeah, mm. I would wholeheartedly like recommend this series because it's nothing that's ever. I mean, like Dragon Age is similar, but that's quite different in its story. Like it's, and it's obviously fantasy setting. Yeah. I have promised Sarah that we'll do a Dragon Age episode with her at some point. So whenever that gets down the line. But yes, Mass Effect is awesome. We all love it. And I'd encourage anyone, like Lee saying he might stream the full series, like I'd watch it. Like I'd check in on you and see what you're up to, see what bad decisions you were making.
Paul Shepherd.
Oh my god. Not Paul Shepherd, he's
Paul Effect.
That's a renegade right there if I ever saw
one. Punching journalists on the Citadel every day.
But is there anything else you guys want to say about the series before we sign off forever one last time?
What are your hopes? What are your hopes for Mass Effect 5?
I'd be happy with a side story that was like Mass Effect 2 sort of timeline, like before the universe is irrevocably changed by Reapers showing up. Because I'd quite like to explore other places in the universe that, you know, like in other like cultures and stuff that we haven't had a massive like look at. But I'm kind of sick of the Reaper world ending thing. So I know they're probably not, but I would be happy with a side story that ignores most of the main stuff.
Yeah. What do you think, Adam?
I don't really know, because like there's all these like speculations thrown around that it's going to be like about Liara and stuff, and that would be awesome if it was, because like she's a cool character. But like I would like to see a totally new character, and like what Jake says, like something that either runs alongside or is like a direct aftermath of 3.
Aftermath would be cool, because then you'd be like, okay, what are you? What is everyone going to do? What does this world look like? But I don't know who could write that.
I would. So I want two possibilities. One, it's hundreds of years into the future.
Right.
We've still got Liara Tassoni, but there's a new character who works alongside her that you play, and somehow it links to the Andromeda Initiative.
Right.
True.
Two,
get Ryder back and you fix their face with galactic credits.
Or two, like Adam said, it's say 10 years after the aftermath of Mass Effect 3.
Yeah,
and we have to actually
repercussions. Yeah, we are dealing with the repercussions. I do think, judging from what we've had this year and on N7 Day this year, it's going to be the first alternative where it's going to be possibly Liara.
Yeah.
Because we've had a lot of, during the teasers they've had the last couple of years, it's been a lot of Liara.
Yeah.
Possibly as an N7. Mm-hmm. Maybe she's the first alien in the N7 program, which would be a good twist compared to the Spectres.
True.
And I think they can't ignore, if they do that, they can't ignore the Andromeda Initiative. Because the whole reason for Mass Effect and the whole reason for the Andromeda Initiative was rich benefactors, who they never mentioned, but it's likely the elusive man, knew the Reapers were coming, so decided to set off a whole colony of alien races to a distant galaxy to propagate the species out there away from the threat of the Reapers. That was the whole point of Andromeda, which is, it's a good idea, but I think they need to link those two worlds together, and I will be very interested to see how they do that. But I don't think we're going to get it until 2026.
Yeah.
BioWare's in a real bad spot at the moment, and like Dragon Age has kind of fell off the face of the earth. Like Dreadwolf is still supposed to be being made, but they haven't shown any of it. There was talk of it being an online, like a live service game, and then I think they backtracked on that. I think someone's just hitting the delete button over and over again at BioWare, being like, nope, start again. And that just makes me really scared.
I think EA has done a lot of backtracking when they went, oh, single player games are dead, and then everyone's like, they're fucking not.
Yeah.
So I think they're just trying to reevaluate and take stock. But we have to be careful with BioWare because EA has a lot of interference with it, and BioWare need to strap on a pair with them and say, you interfered last time and look what happened to the franchise. Yeah. You tanked one of the biggest franchises of two generations of consoles because of your interference.
It was kind of like the shining star of like the 360 PS3 generation, because like there wasn't
Of the time that it came out.
Yeah, there wasn't many like new series rising at that point.
No, definitely not. No, it was like established things that were kept coming out and out and out, wasn't it?
Like 3D versions of like old things, yeah.
but it was like the golden era, because you had like Uncharted, Mass Effect,
Assassin's Creed,
and this stood out like a shining jewel out of all of them. And then, obviously, EA being EA, the cocky fucks that they are, they were like, oh, we'll just put it in Frostbite and it'll be fine. It'll just sell. It'll be fine. They don't care. It'll sell.
It sold a little bit. Like,
it sold a little bit, but then they were like, but then the reviews were like, you can't just shovel this out unfinished and unpolished and think that people are going to buy it.
Do you think one day we might get that TV show they keep talking about as well?
Oh, I don't know.
As long as it was a retelling of the exact Shepard story, I'm fine.
It's a lot of people were like, dude, the Mass Effect movie, and I'm like, no, much like other things, this, as it's an RPG, it works well as a TV series.
It needs to follow the Star Trek model, maybe a few more multiple parter episodes, because you know you'll want the side, like the quest, to be finished, you know, but like it should follow that, where you spend a lot of time on the Normandy, people talk, you know, they solve problems, they go out on missions, they come back. Like it needs time, because it's a long series, and you need the time to sit with the characters.
I think we'll, if anyone, it. So go on.
We'll write it.
It's badly.
I think if anyone's
Shepard
gonna do
kicks them all out the window.
One kick.
If anyone's gonna do a TV series on this, it's gonna be Amazon. but I think a lot of people are going to look at how they pull off Fallout first.
Yes. Yeah.
To see if, because let's, you know, Fallout's an RPG and it's a TV series. Let's just see how they pull this off and how it works. Because I know Henry Cavill or whatever is deeply interested in playing Shepard.
Yeah.
Because he's a huge Mass Effect fan. And you know, like he did on The Witcher, but failed. He would keep them tightly snipped to the lore of the game.
Hopefully.
But it would have to be longer than 10 episodes, because I would do season 1 Mass Effect 1, season 2 Mass Effect 2, season 3 Mass Effect 3, and then I would just do 3 and done. That's it.
Yeah.
You don't need any more than that. But I think 10 to 15.
Because Amazon tends to try and do like 8 episode seasons, and I think that would be rushing it for this particular series.
It would need to build a world in a sci-fi franchise like that, you need more than 10 episodes.
Yeah.
Star Trek gets away with it because we had 26 episode series 30 years ago.
So
that's established. To do that nowadays, you need more than 10 episodes. Or those 10 episodes need to be so fucking perfectly written
and long. like Stranger Things episodes.
Or Game of Thrones.
Yeah, true.
Where it's just like, do you know, oh yeah, we've got 11 episodes, but they're an hour and a half long.
And like, I was mentioning this today, because they're doing Game of Thrones soon on Nerdy Up North, so like Paul was asking what you thought of it. And I was thinking, like, the pacing of Game of Thrones to get through all those books and to keep you like glued to the screen and then wanting to see the next episode, like, that was an achievement. But it's tough to do. You got to have the exact type of writer that knows how to like hook the audience. But hopefully this series does fix itself, you know, well, not itself, but you know, hopefully the BioWare devs like fix it and we get good Mass Effect back. But at least if we don't, everyone's all got their own story, you know, that they sat with for many hours. But yeah, I think we did it, guys. I think we did Mass Effect.
We did. 2 hours?
Oh, that's going to take a lot of editing.
Sorry, every podcast I go on, it makes it last.
Oh, hang on. Hang on. Lee's got an Adam emote somehow in the chat already.
How's he done that?
How's he done that then?
Fueled by brown eggs.
He finished it and then he got to work. It's a process, but he follows it. Oh my god, he's got brown egg emotes as well. Oh mercy.
Yes, I've got my own emote now. I'm part of the crew.
See, that looks like rabbit poo on dark mode. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, on OBS. But oh, that's amazing, Lee. this is why you got hired. But yeah, awesome. Like, this has been really fun. I know we could have like went way longer, but we shouldn't. Short and sweet. But yeah, like, I am Jake of Nerdy Up North. You'll see me all over streams and podcasts. We just did Batman and Robin on Sunday, which was a really fun episode. I'll probably play some games, and you'll see lots of other stuff on this Twitch, including more weekly Ramblecast episodes. Adam, where can the fine folks find you?
They can find me here, obviously.
Look at him, he's here.
Yeah, I'm here, man. But yeah, with Jake every Monday night, rambling about shit and games. Shitty games sometimes, probably.
Yeah.
But you can also find me on TikTok at Adam Ashbridge Music, on Instagram at Adam Ashbridge Music, and Facebook on Adam Ashbridge Music, and also all of the music that's ever going to be done for Nerdy Up North, and the music that was on this episode.
He's got a stranglehold. He's not letting go.
I'm not.
Yeah, Goodwill. Captain Goodwill, Commander Goodwill, where can the fine folks find you?
Mostly throwing up on a toilet somewhere at the moment. But I'm on Twitter at Goodwill None. There is no new Trekking Up North for a little bit till our holiday special.
Oh, yes.
So yeah. We are taking a little bit of shore leave because I miss having free Friday nights.
Yeah,
you need some time to get ready for Life Day, don't you? And hire B. Arthur to do a cooking segment for that.
I need to see Wookiees with human teeth. I'm still recovering from the Sunderland food poisoning because they're like, "Oh, is this? He's a smuggy. Let's kill him."
Did you have brown eggs? That's what I'm saying.
I needed brown eggs. My eggs were undercooked.
Hang on, before you crossed the border, did you line your stomach with Greggs from your own Providence?
Did I immune myself? No, I didn't vaccinate myself.
That's where you went wrong, because whenever I leave the north and go like down south, I have to cross the border with a belly full of Greggs, and it protects
me. I did have a Costa. I did like vaccinate myself with a Costa, but it wasn't sufficient enough to allow my body to succumb to the dangers of Mac and breakfasts, and I've lost my entire body weight. Yeah, let's be good. Lucas said, sponsor me because I've drank off your shit all the last couple of days.
It'll heal your according to our grandparents.
This entire bottle.
Yeah, it usually says warning does not replace bodily fluids lost.
Yeah, it's a diuretic as well, I think. If you
Let's have a look. Whoa, what the hell?
Mm-hmm.
Finally, it may stain, so don't spill it.
Yeah, don't do that.
So what's it doing to your insides then?
Enjoy as part of a varied and balanced diet for healthy lifestyle. Mm-hmm. I'm literally just been throwing up on the toilet for 2 days. How is that? Is that a healthy lifestyle?
It didn't fix it.
It didn't.
I've heard that you've also got a podcast of your own.
I've heard that as well, yeah.
Do I?
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, so you're going on hiatus, but are you going to be back in the new year? Is that what's happening?
You're
going to come back with a bang? What have you got planned?
No, it's been cancelled. It's been cancelled. We've been replaced by something superior.
Paul finally cancelled it. Pulled the plug.
He's doing a Babylon 5 podcast because he's a twat.
Babylon and up north.
Babylon and No, we're back in the new year. January, check in the calendar. January the 5th, We will be back. We will be doing, on the holiday special, we will spin the dabble wheel of episodes for the last time. And we're going to have more structure next year. So we've got two random episodes. One episode where we possibly just get drunk and talk about party episodes on Riser. Then review a Star Trek movie a month, starting with the motion picture. So that also will be a drinking episode.
Nice. I think I'm jealous of your wheel. I think we're going to get a square to spin.
We were hoping for a quiet episode for our last one, and it was like, nope, two-parter, original series, off you go.
Yeah. Oh, well, no, everyone loves the Star Trek cast, and that's why I had to get you on for this, to be our first guest, because we were talking something near and dear and related. Synergy.
If you ever do Uncharted,
Cyber Initiative.
Yes. That's conglomerate mergeability, as Barney Stinson would say.
How do you feel about becoming a cyborg at some point?
I welcome our cybernetic overlords. Adam, they can't be any better than the Conservative government.
Write that down. We've got another one. That's Ducky and Goodwill have now volunteered. Yep. It's a verbal binding agreement.
Yep.
But yes, nope. This has been the Gaming Up North Ramblecast, the Gun Show, as we're definitely calling it. But yeah, this is goodbye from me.
And goodbye from me.
Bye!
Live long and play video games. That's the famous line. Goodbye, guys!